Mike Rell married his first wife, Dee Hoffman, in 1979 while they were students at the University of Florida in Gainesville. Mike seemed to have it all from a young age, exhibiting a remarkable set of qualities. He was a Boy Scout who nearly attained the rank of Eagle Scout and served as an altar boy, reflecting his strong moral and ethical values. During his time at the University of Florida, Mike continued to excel. He was actively involved in a fraternity, which provided him with a supportive community and opportunities for growth. His athletic abilities and academic achievements made him a standout student. Mike went on to earn a master's in business administration from the University of Miami, setting him on a path of personal and professional success. Dee, Mike's wife, once remarked that Mike was a genuinely supportive husband who never physically abused her. However, their relationship eventually reached a breaking point. Despite their outward success, they faced challenges behind the scenes. The couple had two daughters, Caroline and Kate, who Mike loved dearly. However, his demanding career often kept him away from his family, and his daughters grew accustomed to his absence during their formative years. After 25 years of marriage, Dee approached Mike and requested a divorce. She moved out of their shared home, intending to provide a place for Caroline and Kate to return to during college breaks. At 49, Mike found himself single for the first time in a long while. Seeking to find love again, he decided to try internet dating, which was gaining popularity in the mid-2000s. Mike created a profile on Match.com and soon connected with a 38-year-old Hispanic nurse named Susan. As Mike and Susan's relationship developed, they enjoyed wonderful dates and trips together. Not long after their initial meeting, Susan moved into Mike's home, taking over the space once occupied by Dee. In an interview with 48 Hours, Dee shared her feelings about Susan's arrival in Mike's life, expressing that everything that had once been hers now belonged to Susan, including her dog. When Mike's daughter Caroline first met Susan, she was concerned. Caroline was struck by how much Susan drank during their initial encounter, consuming several martinis yet remaining upright and engaging in conversation. This behavior was unlike anything Caroline had ever witnessed, raising alarm bells in her mind. Despite Caroline's reservations, Mike and Susan married in 2007. This union marked a turning point in their relationship. Susan stopped working, and Mike ceased traveling for work, purchasing a local business called Ocala Dental, which became the center of their lives. To the outside world, Mike and Susan appeared to be the ideal couple, living in a wealthy neighborhood in Alachua County, Florida, and often joking about their perfect life together. However, behind the facade, Mike and Susan faced significant struggles in their marriage. In the summer of 2007, Mike drafted a prenuptial agreement with Susan, raising eyebrows among friends and family, as they had always been seen as a strong and united couple. The catalyst for this decision was an incident at one of his daughter's house parties, where Susan, known for her fierce temperament, used excessive profanity in front of Mike's daughter, leading to a heated argument. This incident prompted Mike to consider protecting his assets in case of a potential divorce, despite their outward appearance of financial stability. There were underlying issues beneath the surface of Mike and Susan's relationship. Susan confided in Mike that she had accumulated $35,000 in credit card debt, which deeply troubled him. One of the major sources of tension between them was Susan's dislike of Mike's daughters. Caroline mentioned that she could only interact with her father when he was alone in his car, as Susan's hostility toward his daughters created a barrier that made meaningful conversations difficult. Despite these challenges, Mike and Susan's relationship seemed to stabilize, at least outwardly. In 2016, when Caroline announced her engagement, Susan became deeply involved, insisting on playing a significant role in every aspect of the wedding. Susan even took it upon herself to throw Caroline a bridal shower, a gesture typically reserved for the bride's mother or sister. However, Susan deliberately excluded Caroline's mother's friends from the guest list, while ensuring that her own friends and family were invited. Despite the initial awkwardness of Susan's involvement, Caroline admitted that the day was enjoyable, as Susan put considerable effort into making the occasion fun and memorable. When Caroline was shopping for her wedding gown, Susan accompanied her to the bridal boutique. Together, they browsed through various dresses until Caroline found one that captured her imagination. Susan even paid for the $1,000 gown with her own credit card. In November 2017, Caroline married at Ohika Castle in Long Island, surrounded by 160 guests, in a wedding that exuded grandeur and luxury. Before Mike walked Caroline down the aisle, she noticed an unusual mark on his face. When she inquired about it, Mike brushed off her concerns, not wanting to upset her on her special day. However, 3 weeks after the wedding, Mike confided in Caroline that the mark, now a long white scar, was a result of physical abuse by his wife, Susan. He revealed that Susan had been arrested for domestic battery after becoming violent while intoxicated. According to Susan's version of the incident, after Caroline's wedding, Mike informed her that the event had gone $150,000 over budget. This revelation angered Susan, and the argument between them escalated. During the altercation, Susan threw a mobile phone at Mike and pushed him in an attempt to defuse the situation. However, it was Susan who ultimately called 911 to report the incident. According to her, she offered to go to the couple's beach condo to calm down, but she delayed leaving the residence, leading to her arrest when she had still not left the premises. The court ordered Susan to stay away from Mike, and she sought alcohol counseling and anger management services. Several weeks later, Mike decided not to press charges, and the case was dropped. Susan moved out of their home and into a condo in Ponte Vedra. While this provided a temporary reprieve from the couple's ongoing drama, it was short-lived. On February 3, 2018, at 4 a.m., Mike made a chilling call to 911 from his home in Gainesville, Florida. He informed the dispatcher that someone had entered his house and that his wife, Susan, was bleeding profusely. When the police arrived at the scene, they found Susan lying severely injured on a bed in the master bedroom. Medics were immediately summoned, and with a sense of urgency, they rushed her to the nearest hospital. As Susan was taken into surgery, the medical team worked tirelessly to save her, but her condition remained critical. The odds were not in Susan's favor, and her chances of survival seemed slim. Meanwhile, a detective arrived at Mike's home, now cordoned off as a crime scene. He began a meticulous search of the premises, carefully examining the scene for any clues. What he discovered sent shivers down his spine. The master bedroom was drenched in blood, with a bent, bloody knife lying on the bed. However, there were no signs of forced entry, no broken doors or shattered windows. To piece together the events leading up to the incident, the detective obtained security camera footage from Mike's home. After thoroughly reviewing the footage, he found no evidence of anyone fleeing from the house. Despite the grim circumstances, Susan miraculously survived the ordeal, though she was left with severe wounds to her wrists, stomach, and neck. When Susan regained consciousness in the hospital, she made a shocking revelation to the detectives handling the case. There was no intruder. According to Susan, it was Mike who had attacked her. She claimed that Mike had fabricated the story about a break-in. Susan recounted that they had started arguing while at a local restaurant for dinner, leading them to return home in separate cars. Once home, Susan went straight to bed. As she was drifting off to sleep, she suddenly felt a sharp stabbing pain. When she opened her eyes, she saw Mike standing over her, holding a knife. Panic and confusion flooded Susan's mind as she realized the danger she was in. She screamed, "Michael, you're going to kill me!" To her horror, Mike coldly replied, "That's exactly what I want to do." Susan's cries for help went unheard as Mike continued his assault, leaving her covered in blood and in excruciating pain. For an hour, Susan lay in the bed, bleeding profusely and fearing for her life. Mike then told Susan he wouldn't kill her if she agreed to stick to his story about an intruder. Desperate to stay alive, Susan reluctantly agreed. Mike then changed his clothes and called 911, pretending that a robbery had taken place. Mike Rell was arrested on charges related to the attempted murder of his wife, Susan. The news shocked everyone, including Mike's ex-wife Dee and his daughters, Caroline and Kate. Dee, who had divorced Mike years earlier, was in disbelief when she heard about the arrest. During their marriage, She had never seen any signs of violence or aggression and couldn't fathom that her former husband was now accused of such a heinous crime. Similarly, Caroline and Kate were overwhelmed by the news. They had always admired and respected their father, considering him a generous and kind man. The thought that he could commit such a violent act against their stepmother seemed unimaginable. As the case unfolded, additional charges were brought against Mike. Besides attempted murder, he was also indicted on charges of false imprisonment, obstruction, and tampering with evidence. These charges further complicated the case and heightened its severity. Due to Mike's wealth and influence, the judge set a bond of $2.5 million for the additional charges, but no bond was granted for the attempted murder charge, given the serious nature of the crime. Mike Rell's arrest sent shockwaves through the community. Many who knew him and his family struggled to reconcile their perception of him with the severity of the charges against him. Several months after his February 2018 arrest, Mike faced additional legal troubles. On June 29, he was arrested and charged with criminal attempt to solicit and conspire on a capital felony. These charges stemmed from allegations that Mike had tried to hire an inmate to murder his wife, Susan. According to the state's attorney's office, Mike sought the assistance of 33-year-old Rodri Jermaine McCullum, who also faced charges related to the alleged murder-for-hire plot. The trial, which took place in 2019, revealed insights into the tumultuous dynamics of Mike and Susan's relationship. Throughout the proceedings, Mike portrayed their marriage as strained and turbulent. He testified that they had limited visitors to their home, a restriction he claimed was primarily due to Susan's reluctance to have his friends from his former university's advisory board over. Another source of tension in their marriage was Mike's philanthropic endeavors. Mike enjoyed making charitable donations, which often led to conflicts with Susan. According to his testimony, Susan would frequently threaten to divorce him if he attended committee meetings, country club events, or made donations without her permission. While Mike claimed to face backlash over his charitable contributions, Susan's spending habits went unchecked. He testified that she often purchased clothing and jewelry without consulting him, adding to the financial strain on their marriage. Mike also described instances of violence as a means of conflict resolution in their relationship. He recounted a July 2016 incident in which Susan allegedly threw a wine bottle at him from the top of the staircase, hitting him in the shoulder. This, he said, was not an isolated incident. Susan had thrown vases and heavy mugs at him on other occasions. Despite these violent episodes, Mike admitted he never reported them to the police nor sought help, although he did take photos of his injuries and shared them with his daughter Caroline. Throughout the trial, Mike maintained that despite enduring abuse, he loved Susan and wanted to remain married to her. However, he confessed that he constantly felt like he was walking on eggshells, always fearing her retaliation. In an attempt to reconcile, Mike invited Susan to dinner on February 3, 2018, taking her to their favorite steakhouse. He hoped that a change of scenery and a romantic evening might help mend their relationship. However, during the dinner, Mike received a text message from his daughter Caroline, which angered Susan. The atmosphere turned tense and awkward, and Susan eventually left the restaurant in an Uber. Mike followed her home in his car. On the way home, Susan sent Mike a text message that read, "Good luck with that __," referring to his daughter Caroline. She believed Caroline would sabotage any future relationship Mike had. When they arrived home, they continued to communicate only through text messages. Susan informed Mike that she planned to file for divorce and would leave the next morning. At approximately 10:13 p.m., she sent him one final text, criticizing his serious boundary issues with his daughter. According to Susan, she was alone in the guest room when Mike suddenly entered and jumped on top of her. She felt pressure in her upper abdomen and saw a knife in Mike's hand. When she asked if he had stabbed her, Mike allegedly admitted that he had. Susan claimed Mike then told her that they were not getting a divorce, leading to a violent struggle during which her left thumb was sliced. Susan testified that Mike stabbed her multiple times and slashed at her wrists during their altercation, leaving her with severe injuries. She described losing a significant amount of blood, which caused her to vomit and lose control of her muscles and bodily functions. According to Susan, Mike told her that he would lie beside her until she died. Struggling to stay conscious, Susan said that Mike concocted a story about an intruder attacking her to cover up the incident. Mike's version of events differed significantly. He claimed that he walked into the bedroom to find Susan on the bed holding a knife. A struggle ensued, and as they fell onto the bed, the knife accidentally wounded Susan's stomach. However, Mike could not explain how Susan also sustained injuries to her neck and thumb. He testified that he intended to call 911 after accidentally injuring Susan, but she allegedly pleaded with him not to, fearing she would be arrested again for domestic violence. Instead, Mike said they lay together for several hours, during which he claimed they had one of the best conversations of their lives, discussing future travel plans to Germany, Tuscany, Florence, Greece, and a river cruise. The prosecution painted a different picture, arguing that if Mike's account was accurate, then this conversation took place on a bed soaked in blood, vomit, and excrement. Mike testified that around 3 a.m., their dog Susie walked into the bloody bedroom, prompting him to get up and tend to her. During this time, he claimed Susan grabbed the knife and slit her wrists, expressing her fear of going to jail. Mike told the court that he assured Susan he would protect her, deciding to lie to the police and turn off the security cameras to stage a break-in. At around 5:25 a.m., he called 911 and turned the cameras back on. The prosecution argued that Mike's actions demonstrated an intent to harm Susan. They contended that his willingness to lie and manipulate the surveillance cameras indicated an attempt to cover up his involvement in the crime. In contrast, the defense claimed that Mike's actions were motivated by his desire to protect his wife. They argued that Susan's attempted suicide resulted from her mental health struggles and that Mike was trying to save her when he turned off the cameras and lied to the police. A bloodstain pattern analyst testified on Mike's behalf, stating that the medical records supported his version of events. The analyst suggested that if Susan's wrist had been cut around 10 p.m. as she claimed, she would have likely died from blood loss. In contrast, if Mike's story were accurate, it would explain how she survived until medical help arrived. The prosecution refuted Mike's claims of wanting to reconcile with Susan, presenting evidence that he had visited 3 dating sites, implying a lack of interest in saving the marriage. However, Mike's defense countered by showing that he had also accessed websites dedicated to battered husbands. After a 9-day trial, the jury deliberated for 4 hours before returning with a verdict. Mike was found guilty of attempted first-degree murder and additional charges. In December 2019, he was sentenced, although Susan did not attend the hearing. Mike's daughter, Caroline, addressed the court, expressing pride in being her father's daughter and describing him as compassionate and selfless. Several friends also testified, describing Mike as a kind, gentle person and a stand-up gentleman. Despite the prosecution's request for a 50-year sentence, the judge sentenced Mike to 30 years. Given his age at the time, it is likely that Mike will spend the rest of his life in prison.
Today, we're diving into the chilling case of Carly Goose. It was the morning of October 13th, 2018, when Carly Lane Goose's stepmother woke up to a situation that haunts every parent's worst fears, a nightmare that no one wants to face. "I miss you so much," she said. "The whole world misses you." The door of their house in Mono County, California, was slightly open, and Carly, just 16 years old, was nowhere to be found. She had completely disappeared. From that moment on, no one has seen Carly Goose again. It was as if she vanished into thin air. As more details began to emerge about the case, the bizarre chain of events leading to her disappearance came to light. For many, it painted a deeply troubling picture. Carly lived with her father, Zachary Goose, her stepmother, Melissa, and her 2 younger brothers in a quiet, rural part of California. Carly's parents had divorced when she was just a little girl, and later, she decided to live with her dad. Her biological mom, Lindsay Fairley, had moved to Nevada. Despite her parents' separation, Carly seemed to adapt well to the changes in her life, a situation that can often be tough for a child to handle. Those who knew Carly described her as a sweet, funny, and well-liked girl. her biological mom, Lindsay, even said they were best friends. But in the days leading up to Carly's disappearance, her behavior started to change. According to one of her friends, Carly began having what they called episodes. She had become convinced that someone was tracking her through her phone. What makes this even creepier is that, to this day, no one knows what caused Carly to believe she was being followed. Despite these odd and fearful moments, life went on as usual for Carly and her family. On Friday evening, October 12th, 2018, Carly asked her parents if she could attend her high school's football game. They gave her the green light. However, she never actually went to the game. Instead, she ended up at a house party with her boyfriend, Donald. That night would be the last time he ever saw her. This is where things take a truly strange and unsettling turn. Something seemed very off about Carly that night. It was clear to those around her that something had scared her badly. Whatever happened at that party deeply disturbed her, leading to an unforgettable and disastrous night. Later that evening, around 8 p.m., Carly's stepmother, Melissa, called to check if she needed a ride home from the football game. Initially, Carly said she didn't need a ride and that her boyfriend, Donald, would take her home. "My daughter told me she was going to get a ride home with Donald," Lindsay recalled. But soon after, things took a dramatic shift. While everyone else was enjoying the party, Carly started to panic. She became frantic and was nearly impossible to calm down. Donald later said, "She got scared of the music. She even got scared of me." Whatever frightened Carly that night shook her so badly that she no longer cared about keeping up the lie that she was at the football game. Less than an hour later, Carly called her stepmom again, this time begging to be picked up, saying she had changed her mind. "Never mind, hurry up, I changed my mind, come get me. I'm running down Dixon Lane. Hurry, hurry, I'm scared." Carly's fear was undeniable. Melissa immediately said she'd come to pick her up. Carly also admitted that she hadn't gone to the football game at all, but had been at a party instead. On her way to pick Carly up, Melissa remembered how panicked her stepdaughter sounded on the phone. Carly didn't want to hang up and insisted that she come right away. She was clearly terrified and wanted to be picked up as soon as possible. But when Melissa arrived at the trailer park that night, Carly was nowhere in sight. Melissa drove around, searching for her stepdaughter in the dark. That's when she noticed a faint light coming toward her. Guided by the glow of her phone, Carly was rushing straight toward Melissa's car, running through the pitch-black night. In a state of complete panic, Carly jumped into the back seat of the car. According to Melissa, she was pale like a ghost. Her pupils were huge. Even though Carly was now in the safety of the car and far from whatever had scared her, she couldn't calm down. She was still terrified, moving frantically from one seat to another, convinced the car was going to harm her. She kept repeating how scared she was. Later, Melissa told the police that Carly had admitted to smoking something at the party, and she seemed extremely paranoid and jittery, even after they got home. At one point, Melissa spent nearly 15 minutes trying to soothe Carly, but she didn't take her to the hospital because she didn't believe Carly was in immediate danger. Melissa thought Carly was just having a bad reaction to whatever she had taken, but Carly's alarming behavior didn't end there. Once back home, both Melissa and Carly's father, Zachary, noticed that she was still acting very strangely. Zachary, who had just gotten home from work and had a couple of beers, said that Carly was acting in a way that was completely out of character. She would sit in a corner, seeming scared of her parents one moment, and the next, she'd tell them how much she loved them. Zachary also noticed that she seemed especially frightened of her phone and her parents being near her. Melissa and Zachary repeatedly asked Carly what was wrong, but she kept telling them she didn't know. She begged Melissa to stay with her through the night, wanting to paint her toenails, color, and read the Bible. Her mood swung wildly. One moment she was fine, the next she was back to being deeply paranoid. It was a roller coaster of emotions, with no clear explanation. During this time, Melissa, frustrated and concerned, decided to secretly record Carly on her phone. She thought it might help Carly understand the next day just how much her behavior had changed after whatever she'd smoked. Melissa intended to use the recording as a lesson, showing Carly what she was like while under the influence, especially since she had already been suspended from school for a month for using the same substance and had to attend on-campus counseling. Although these videos have not been released to the public, some details have surfaced about them. They reportedly show Carly repeatedly saying she's scared, though she doesn't know why. But when Carly's private investigators got hold of the footage and showed it to her biological mother, Lindsay Fairley, she claimed it painted a much darker picture. According to Lindsay, the video shows Carly begging Melissa to call 911, but Melissa refused. However, Melissa later clarified that in one video, Carly asked, "If something happens, would you call 911? To which Melissa replied, "Of course." Fox News was given access to one of the recordings and revealed more about Carly's fragile mental state that night. It was unsettling, to say the least. According to Fox, Carly's shaky voice was filled with anxiety as she said she didn't want to sleep, afraid that something might happen to her. She also asked Melissa to call 911 if needed. Throughout the night, Carly repeatedly apologized and continued to panic, expressing love for her stepmom and talking to her with a mixture of fear and confusion. Melissa seemed to calmly talk Carly down, keeping her company until after 3 a.m., trying to ease her troubled mind as best as she could. Doug Carey from the app Las Vegas Review-Journal also listened to the audio recording of Carly from that night. In the 8-minute clip, Carly is heard saying, "I really messed up today." Melissa tried to comfort her by responding, "We all make mistakes, especially with substances." Despite Melissa's attempt to calm her down, Carly was still unsettled. She refused to sleep, saying, "No, I don't want to go to sleep. You're going to kill me." Melissa tried reasoning with her, saying, "Why would I kill you? That's ridiculous." But Carly, sobbing, replied, "I keep thinking about all this demonic stuff. I can't help it." After the video was recorded, Melissa attempted to get Carly to eat something before going to bed. She offered her a salad and an energy bar, but Carly refused both. She even spat out the salad, calling it the devil's lettuce. According to a Facebook comment supposedly written by Melissa, Carly spent hours writing on a piece of paper that night. What she wrote, however, remains a mystery. What could she have been writing for so long? While trying to keep Carly calm, Melissa was texting Carly's boyfriend Donald, who was very concerned. One particular text Melissa sent at 1:27 a.m. caught the attention of many internet sleuths. In it, she asked Donald to pray for Carly. Some found this message strange and suspicious. As the night dragged on, Carly's paranoia only got worse. In one of Melissa's Facebook live streams, she explained that Carly became so terrified that she refused to let Melissa out of her sight, insisting on staying close to her stepmother throughout the night. Carly even asked Melissa if she would sleep with her for safety. Melissa agreed, saying, "Sure, I'll play with you and we can watch a movie." But then, the unthinkable happened. Here is where Melissa's story starts to become unclear, and it has sparked a lot of suspicion online. Initially, Melissa claimed she had put Carly to bed and spent the night in her own room. She said she checked on Carly and her brothers around 5:45 a.m., finding everything normal. But when she checked again around 7:45 a.m., Carly was gone. Melissa recalled gasping in shock. "Carly Lane Goose is missing. She's been missing since..." and then stopped, struggling to breathe as she spoke. However, Melissa later changed her story, saying that she had actually stayed beside Carly all night to make sure she was safe. She explained that the last time she saw Carly was at around 5:45 a.m., still lying in bed but wide awake with her eyes open. Melissa said she briefly woke up, saw Carly, and then fell back asleep. When she woke up again around 7:15 to 7:30 a.m., Carly was gone. The front door was left slightly open, and there was a single fresh footprint, believed to be Carly's, on the driveway. The changes in Melissa's account raised a lot of eyebrows. Many people were troubled by how such important details kept changing, especially coming from one of the last people to see Carly before she vanished. Was Melissa just an overwhelmed stepmother, unsure of what to say when reporters first started asking questions? Or did she feel guilty for not watching Carly more closely that night? After discovering that Carly was missing, Melissa and her husband Zachary assumed Carly had gone for a walk to clear her head. Worried about her mental state from the night before, they both got in their cars and began driving around the neighborhood, desperately trying to find her. When they couldn't locate her, Zachary called his ex-wife, Carly's biological mother, Lindsay, to tell her that their daughter was missing. Lindsay felt something was off about that phone call. She explained, "At 9:35 a.m. on Saturday, October 13th, I got a call from her father, my ex-husband, telling me she was gone. Gone was a huge red flag for me. It has never sat right with me." After notifying Lindsay, Zachary called the Mono County Sheriff's Department to report Carly as missing. What made the situation even more alarming was that Carly's cell phone was still at home. This was very unlike her, as most teenagers are rarely without their phones. This added to their growing fears. Donald, Carly's boyfriend, rushed over to her house after hearing the devastating news that she was missing. According to Carly's boyfriend, Donald, he distinctly remembered seeing her phone by her bed. But Melissa claimed the phone had been sitting on the kitchen island the entire time. This small yet odd detail adds to the confusion surrounding Carly's disappearance. When the police launched their investigation, they found three separate witnesses who reported seeing someone matching Carly's description walking through the neighborhood early on the morning she disappeared. The Mono County Sheriff's Department stated that these witnesses were very reliable, and they had no reason to doubt their accounts. The first two witnesses knew Carly personally, which made their testimonies even more credible. The third witness did not know her, but still reported seeing a girl who looked like Carly. One of these witnesses was an educator, another was a retired law enforcement officer, and the final witness was a woodworker. One of the neighbors, Richard Eddy, who lived just down the street from the Gusses, said he saw a girl with long hair walking past his house at around 6:30 to 6:45 a.m. He was sitting in his jacuzzi drinking coffee when he noticed the girl. He recalled, "She was looking up, looking around at the sky, and she was holding a piece of paper. It seemed unusual," he said. "We don't usually have kids walking around at that time." Another neighbor, Kenneth Dutton, who lived nearby, also reported seeing Carly that same morning, and like Richard, he noticed she was holding a piece of paper in her hand. Some of Carly's family members speculated that the paper might have been related to her counseling sessions, which she had been attending before her disappearance. In an interview with Dateline, Melissa mentioned that the third witness, the woodworker, claimed to have seen someone resembling Carly near the corner of Highway 6, about a mile from her family's home. The girl was mysteriously standing behind a barbed wire fence at around 7 to 7:30 a.m. Another part of the case that raised suspicion was Melissa's inconsistent description of what Carly was wearing when she went missing. Initially, Melissa reported that Carly was last seen in a white t-shirt and skinny jeans, but after the witness sightings, Melissa's account seemed to shift. She then said Carly had been wearing gray sweatpants, which some people thought conveniently aligned with the descriptions given by the witnesses. Later, while speaking on Nancy Grace's podcast, Melissa gave yet another version of events. She said that the last time she saw Carly, she was wearing a t-shirt and undergarments. She wasn't sure if gray sweatpants or skinny jeans were missing from Carly's clothes, explaining that her stepdaughter had too many clothes to keep track of. Despite several reported sightings and extensive search efforts involving scent tracking dogs and helicopters, Carly has remained missing for almost a year and a half. Over time, her case garnered nationwide attention, and it went viral across social media. Thousands of people joined Facebook groups like Bring Carly Home and Justice for Carly Goose, hoping to uncover some piece of information that could lead to a breakthrough in her disappearance. However, in October 2019, a detective from the Mono County Sheriff's Department stated, "We are no closer to finding Carly." Meanwhile, the once united groups of people seeking justice for Carly began to fracture. Tensions grew and the online communities descended into drama, with members turning against each other. People became divided into two camps, each holding different theories about what really happened to Carly Goose. These contrasting views only deepened the mystery surrounding her disappearance. These two opposing groups have become embroiled in a highly personal and heated battle, with accusations of doxing and harassment flying between both sides. Each camp has its own sources and information regarding Carly's disappearance, but much of it cannot be independently verified. We're going to dive into both perspectives now, so you can decide for yourself. One of the darkest and most persistent theories surrounding Carly's disappearance puts her stepmother Melissa Goose at the center of the mystery. Carly's biological mother Lindsay strongly supports this theory, and many online communities, including Reddit, have explored the idea. Some believe that Melissa may have accidentally caused Carly's death after mishandling her reaction to whatever substances she had taken at the party. According to this theory, Melissa then allegedly scrambled to cover up the situation. A lot of the evidence used to support this idea stems from the fact that Melissa changed certain details of her story over time. Some have criticized her for being inconsistent, and this has fueled suspicions. In response to the growing skepticism, Melissa has said, "There's no need for negativity. A lot of people are bashing, and I don't care. To that person, you don't know me. You don't know what I'm going through, what we're going through." One detail that raised red flags for many people was a claim that Melissa had suspicious work done on her car shortly after Carly's disappearance. This fueled even more speculation. Melissa once mentioned driving her car, a Corolla, through rough terrain, saying, "I drove my Corolla out in the boonies, over boulders." This led some to theorize that Melissa might have accidentally hit and fatally injured Carly during the search and then tried to cover it up. Others who support this theory focus on Melissa's behavior in her Facebook Live videos. They claim her eyes frequently darted around the screen as she filmed, and they point out how the information she provided often changed. Critics also noted that Melissa didn't seem to question where Carly might be or make any public pleas directly asking for her return. This led skeptics to wonder, does Melissa already know what happened, making it impossible for Carly to come home, or is she simply dealing with her grief in her own way? However, Melissa and Zachary did, in fact, speak directly to Carly during a press conference held by the Mono County Sheriff's Department on October 11, 2019. Another disturbing element that has fueled this camp's theory is the account of Carly's biological mother, Lindsay. She claims to have heard the audio recorded on the night before Carly vanished, and according to her, there was some kind of scuffle at the end of the recording. When Lindsay asked what happened, Melissa allegedly walked away without answering. Lindsay also shared an alarming post on Facebook, quoting Zachary as saying, "At least you have an alibi, Lindsay. You're in Nevada." This further fueled the suspicions of those who believe Melissa was involved in Carly's disappearance. Some members of this camp have become so deeply invested in this theory that their behavior borders on obsessive. One Facebook user claimed to have heard from multiple sources that Melissa and Zachary pulled Carly's two younger brothers out of school shortly after she went missing. Someone even chimed in, asking, "Has anyone talked to the teachers?" This group believes that the inconsistencies in Melissa's story aren't as significant as they've been made out to be. They argue that there are other theories to consider, and they also point to disturbing alleged clues leading up to Carly's disappearance that haven't been widely discussed. According to some posts, Carly had called a hotline for people in distress just weeks before she vanished. She was reportedly struggling with her mental health and had a difficult relationship with her boyfriend, Donald. This has led some to believe that Carly's disappearance might have been a result of her own internal struggles, rather than any wrongdoing by Melissa or anyone else. Carly also had a counselor at the local medical center, and according to the Charlie Project, her last text to her boyfriend at 10:15 p.m. mentioned that the substance she smoked may have been laced. This raises the possibility that Carly was still dealing with severe paranoia and erratic behavior from the previous night. Could she have wandered off into the desert that surrounded her rural neighborhood, only to become a victim of the harsh environment? Another question that lingers is whether Carly took a different substance that night, which could explain her large, dilated pupils. Interestingly, not long before her disappearance, she had asked her biological mother about a psychedelic drug. Some people also point to what they see as strange behavior from Donald on the night Carly panicked. This theory gained traction based on an alleged comment he made in a Facebook group. In a post, Donald allegedly wrote, "No, me and Carly were walking almost to my house and she got so scared it started scaring me. I looked her in the eyes and said, 'Carly, baby, you're safe with me.' But then she got this horrified look on her face and started screaming my name. I tried to hold her to calm her down, but she bit my side and pushed me away. I let go, and she told me not to follow her, to go home. I stood in the middle of the street for like 20 minutes. I wanted to go after her, but it was pitch black, and I didn't want to scare her more. To this day, I wish I had chased her. I wish we had made it to my house. I wish none of this happened. As if that wasn't strange enough, about 10 days after Carly went missing, Donald made another statement on Facebook, claiming there was no party the night before she disappeared. He wrote, "No party, Carly got picked up on the way to my house," and added, "Neither of us had been to any parties, and no, I wasn't at any party the next night either." This completely conflicts with many media reports, including NBC News, which stated that Carly's mother, Lindsay, said Donald had later explained how after hanging out with friends for a while, Carly started to feel unwell and wanted to leave the party. In a private conversation that was shared on Facebook, Donald allegedly clarified his story further. He reportedly said, "Me and Carly did smoke. It was at my friend's house around 7 p.m., not at a party. She got very scared, so we started walking back to my house. Carly freaked out and ran away from me. She called Melissa, and that was the last time I saw her. She started screaming my name and pushing me away, telling me to stay away. That's when she called Melissa and ran off. I tried to calm her down." Another possibility is that Carly may have encountered one of the many travelers who passed by on the highway she was allegedly seen walking near. People in the Facebook groups dedicated to her return have pointed out that truck drivers frequently use this highway for early morning routes. Some believe that she might have been picked up by someone with bad intentions, such as a person involved in kidnapping young girls. Police were able to find what they believe were Carly's footprints along the highway, but unfortunately, they couldn't follow any clear path from the evidence. If Carly was still experiencing the effects of whatever substance she had taken that night, she might have fallen victim to someone passing by while she was in a confused state of mind. At only 5 feet 7 inches and weighing just 115 pounds, she could have been vulnerable. Despite the efforts of search teams using helicopters and scent dogs to comb the area near her home and along the highway, nothing has been found. It's possible she could have slipped into a ravine or some other secluded area, unable to find her way back home. No matter how Carly disappeared from her bed that night, a year and a half ago, the search for answers continues. The nation remains hopeful, waiting for any clue that might lead to Carly Goose's whereabouts. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe for more content. Share your theories in the comments below. What do you think happened to Carly Goose? A playlist will pop up now with more videos you'll love. Click on it and we'll see you next time.